Welcome to another episode of the Boxing Trade Show. Today I'll be talking all things Isaac Chamberlain, Michael Lowell, Jack Catterall, and the upcoming shows. Hamza Shiraz against Liam Williams, and Denzel Bentley against Nathan Heaney. Hope you enjoy this one. Cheers, guys.
Right, guys. Welcome to another episode of the BBTV Boxing Trade Show with me, George Mallett, and you, Greg Cook. First of all, Greg, how are we doing this fine Monday morning / afternoon, evening?
I'm really good, thank you, mate. Yeah, not bad at all. It's half term, so I finished work a little bit earlier today. And yeah, I thought, because I know you're away gallivanting off this weekend, so we've tried to get this all booked in and sorted nice and early. But yes, all good, thank you, mate. How are you?
Yeah, very good, mate. All ticking over. I'm heading to Krakow this weekend, actually, so that's why. Bit of a stag do, which I'm sort of excited for, let's get it over and done with, I suppose.
No, I hope you enjoy it, mate. Good luck.
Yeah. So don't ask me about the boxing this weekend coming, but you can ask me plenty on the weekend that's just gone, which is obviously pretty exciting for different reasons. Not a particularly exciting fight, but maybe for what it tees up. Is that Jack Catterall sort of not outclassing, because how can you outclass a fighter that isn't probably in his best days, but in terms of just comprehensively beating Jorge Linares? What did you make of that one, Greg?
I really enjoyed Saturday night, to be fair. I know we're going to touch on, what was Dan Azeez and Buatsi, and then it ended up being Lowell and Isaac Chamberlain. And I was going to, if I had to pick between the two, I was going to pick Dan Azeez and Joshua Buatsi. And I know we're going to, like we said, come on to that. And when I seen that main event wasn't happening, I thought, well, I'm going to switch over and have the night watching the card from Liverpool. And I've got to say, it's the first time in a while I've sat down, had a takeaway, had a few beers, and watched a night of boxing, and I actually thoroughly enjoyed it. I'm not going to say it was an amazing card, but it had, like, you know, Bellotti and Akib Fiaz, solid fight. Bellotti was a bit of a seasoned pro at his level, British and Commonwealth level, against Akib Fiaz, who was coming up. It was a good fight. Peter McGrail got buzzed early on, but came through well. And there was a young Liverpudlian lad on the undercard just before Peter McGrail. For the life of me, he's gone, isn't he? He was brilliant. He was absolutely brilliant. And then,
not
yeah.
Paddy Lacey?
No, he was fighting a lad called Yahya or something.
Oh, yeah. Jack Turner.
That's him. Yeah. He was brilliant. Really good. And again, I understand the levels, and I understand it's going to be early days for him, but really liked him. And then, yeah, I sat and watched Catterall and Linares. I thought it was a slow start, and Catterall then came into the fight nicely. Linares, I've always had a real soft spot for Linares. I loved the Kevin Mitchell fight, and then I was able to watch him against Crawler at the Manchester Arena. Great fights for Crawler. He seems to be a really classy boxer, really, like, classy guy. So I like Linares a lot. And Catterall won the fight convincingly. It was nothing really to write home about, but it was something that Catterall had to do and had to win. And I thought in the interview afterwards, Linares saying he was happy, you know, that Catterall won. He said it was a pleasure to share the ring with him. He was happy that the other man won, because he thought he was that good on the night. And maybe we might have seen the last of Jorge Linares. But all in all, I actually enjoyed the night of boxing on DAZN, and for the first time, like I say, in a long time, I sat down and had a takeaway and a few beers, and I quite enjoyed it, actually, yeah.
Yeah, so I think Jorge Linares formally sort of retired after that, or at least he said he did. He said if he lost, he was going to retire, and then he did. You also had Million Dollar Crawler's brother. Still boggles my brain that he's his brother, because he's loads younger than him, but yeah, he got another win on the undercard in his second fight. And obviously had Campbell Hatton out again. Do you think Campbell Hatton needs a bit of a step up? Do you think the fans are getting a bit bored of these sort of uncompetitive fights, even if he does lose some of them, to be fair?
Potentially. I watched his fight and he was on before the bell and I thought, well, I'll see how he gets on. And the lad who he'd fought, I don't think had fought in like the last 8 years or something like that. I think it was a southpaw. And it was a really scrappy fight. It really was. And Campbell Hatton, you know, I listened to him at the end of the fight, the interview at the end of his fight, and I respected it because he said, look, I'll probably get a lot of stick for that fight, but it's hard to fight against someone like that. It's hard to, you know, try and stop somebody when they've not come to fight, they've come to hold on. I know the lad had points taken off him and it was a disqualification in the 9th round. And the points that he'd had taken off probably would have led to Campbell Hatton winning on points anyway. But I thought Campbell Hatton at the end of the fight, I'm not going to talk about the fight too much because it wasn't a great watch, but that was from the opposition, really. But Campbell Hatton was dead honest. And then Eddie Hearn was as well. And he said, you know, when you go up these levels, you've got to find ways of dealing with them kind of fighters. And they didn't sugarcoat it. They didn't sugarcoat it at all. And I'm not going to sit there as... I think Eddie Hearn was dead right in that. And him saying, you know, when you're coming up against these level of fighters that are just coming to hold on, you do need to be able to manage that and win them fights. And he did win, but you've got to find a way to win, you know, whether it's a convincing points win or not get wrapped up in it. And then Matthew Hatton came on. I think Matthew Hatton speaks really well. And he'd said the exact, he said it's similar. You know, we know we might need to start putting him in 10 rounders, maybe see that first title fight to see what they can get out of him and how good he can be. So, I get where you're coming from. I think they might need to throw him in and see how he does manage it, maybe. I don't know, is he fighting at English level now? Is he fighting below that level and journeyman? I don't know what level you'd put him in, maybe area. But, maybe I think it might be time for them to say, look, let's see, let's roll the dice and see if you can be capable of winning something at that level.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's a good question. You don't really know where he stands. I mean, Jamie Sampson, yeah, bit of a boring fight. He had fought once in the last 8 years. I think he fought a couple of weeks before or whatever. Suppose more interesting for us is what happens next for Jack Catterall on that sort of main event. We kind of need to see him in a big fight again, don't we, really? And when I say big fight, we need to see him in a title fight. How do you sort of feel about what's next for Catterall?
I mean, he's still at super lightweight, and this fight, Josh Taylor, I think, will clearly move up to welterweight after the defeat to Teofimo Lopez. And I think that'd be the right thing to do. Whether Catterall would want to do that or not, I don't know. I think Haney and Regis Prograis are fighting for the WBC super lightweight title. So, and that's on DAZN. I think the plan might be, I'd like to see Catterall win a world title at super lightweight and then move up to welter to rematch Josh Taylor. So we're going to see Haney Prograis for the WBC super lightweight. Whether Eddie Hearn tries to maneuver Catterall into a WBO or an IBF or WBA world title fight, and then maybe fight the winner of Prograis Haney in a unification, I think that would be great. Win a world title, win it at the level, try and have a big fight, whether that's in America, and then move up to welter and rematch Taylor again. If I'm Catterall, I'm sitting there going, I've just won. I arguably won against Taylor. He's now lost. He's having to not necessarily scramble for fights at welterweight. If I'm Catterall, I'm just relaxing. Take me a step back and say, look, let's see what I can get at super lightweight. Try and get a world title, have a big fight. And then I'll come up to Taylor when it suits him because, you know, all the belts are with Crawford at welterweight. Taylor, if he fought Crawford or Spence or, you know, anybody of that caliber, even the likes of Avanesian, I think he's getting beat. So I think Taylor will wait. If I'm Catterall, I'm making Taylor wait and I'm thinking, let's become a world champion and then we'll make that fight happen at welter.
Yeah. Nice. I suppose the belt holders, you talked about Prograis, Haney. Obviously, the other one is Teofimo Lopez. Do you think Teofimo is sort of, would be looking at someone like Jack Catterall? It would kind of, at this stage, it would have to be sort of a voluntary defence. There's probably not enough money on the table to really get Lopez interested in that fight, you reckon?
Good point, actually, to be fair. I mean, yeah, it's Lopez who won all the belts from, or the majority. Was it the IBF and the WBO he won from Taylor?
I think Taylor ended up having to give away a lot of the belts. So in the end, it was just the WBO that he won. Yeah, and I'd have to look up who the others are. But yeah, you mentioned Progre and Haney of WBC. But yeah, it's a less interesting division without Josh Taylor in it, I would say. But yeah, I mean, he can't get down to that weight any longer.
No, I know what you mean. And I think when Taylor was undisputed, and he was exciting when he beat Progre that night of the 0-2 on Eddie Earnshaw, I thought it was a brilliant night and a brilliant fight. Undisputed. And I just felt as though, I don't even think he maybe potentially thought that, you know, he would go down this route of losing all the belts. I think Taylor probably had it in his head of he'd win all the belts, he'd hold on to them the best that he could, then he'd move up in weight and he'd become a two-weight world champion. It hasn't really panned out like that. And that, I feel that has been because of the Cattrall fight. I think people have been lenient and maybe reluctant to fight him. So I think it's a bit of a weird situation at super lightweight. And I think Cattrall's got he's got to manoeuvre himself into that position. It's got to take place in America because Lopez is ultimately world champion. But you're dead right. Is the money in that fight? If I'm Teofimo Lopez, I'm looking at Cattrall and thinking, what's the risk? Well, the risk's quite high because Cattrall's quite a slick boxer, but what's the reward? Am I going to be making the money? So, and Teofimo Lopez isn't daft, and his dad certainly isn't either. So, and they've worked with DAZN and Eddie Earn before. I think when they fought, was it Haney?
Yeah, I can't remember that one, to be honest.
And they, was it Teofimo Lopez? I can't remember who it was they fought. And he was just going mad about the scorecards. I don't know if it was Cambosis, I'm not sure. And they were just going mad at Eddie Earn about it. And I think since then, they've been reluctant to work potentially with DAZN. So it'd be interesting to see how that comes about.
Yeah, we'll have to wait and see for Jack Cattrall. Going up in sort of the bigger weights, we obviously saw that the Buatsi Danaziz fight fell through sort of within the week of the fight, which looked like it was going to pull the whole card, didn't it, really? But to their credit, Boxer sort of had a backup option, which was to go to York Hall and then to keep the Isaac Chamberlain, Michael Lawal fight on. And I think we got a half-decent night of boxing because of it. Sam Gilley also won the Commonwealth title at super welterweight in York Hall. I think he kind of loves it there. And then we also saw Michael Hennessy Jr. lose to Joe Laws in a sort of, well, a relatively entertaining build-up. And yeah, Joe Laws is always going to be a bit of a character at super middleweight. But yeah, what do you sort of make of Isaac Chamberlain at this point in his career and negotiating what we thought was going to be a pretty difficult challenge with Michael Lawal, but kind of negotiating it pretty comfortably?
Yeah, I think, you know, great insight there yourself, George, to be fair. And like I say, I didn't manage to watch the fight, only read bits and pieces afterwards and a couple of my mates who were watching it as well. And I think, you know, just going back to what you said, ultimately I would have watched that night of boxing on Sky if Danaziz and Buatsi had have headlined. I like Buatsi. It would have been interesting to see where his heart felt for him. And I think, like you say, with Isaac Chamberlain, he's always game, Isaac Chamberlain. He's always involved. He's always right up for it. And what I gathered, Lawal wasn't really up for it himself in the fight. And I think Isaac Chamberlain, you know, it's strange because I talk about like Reese Bellotti on the undercard against Aki Fias on the Cattrall Linares fight. And Isaac Chamberlain, I remember when I was really getting into the swing of boxing and understanding things, he was very much part of that next gen, you know, Isaac Chamberlain. Conor Benn was in there, Reese Bellotti, Jake Ball, Danny Dignam, Ted Cheeseman, all these kind of fighters, and Craig Richards as well. Craig Richards was in there. So I've always kind of kept an eye on Isaac Chamberlain and all of them fighters as well that were part of that next gen. And I think Isaac Chamberlain, he's as game as they come. If I'm him, I'm looking at, if I'm Isaac Chamberlain, I'm looking at the winner of Bouazizi Dan Azeez. I don't see why not. I think I would probably say Isaac Chamberlain is on the same, a similar level to Dan Azeez, not a million miles away from him. And I think if he, taking confidence from that fight and headlining, which he's done in the past, taking confidence from that and going and taking that against the winner of Bouazizi Dan Azeez, I think would be the best thing for him. And then if he can progress from that level, then the world's really his oyster at the weight. And yeah, I like the fact that he's game. I like the fact that, you know, he can mix it up and he's game for a fight. So it will be interesting to see where he goes. But if I'm him, I'm eyeing up the winner of Azeez Bouazizi when it's rearranged.
Yeah, he sort of catapulted himself back into contention a little bit. I mean, he's lost twice, and that was obviously against Lawrence Okolie in a bit of a bore fest, and then Billum Smith in a bit of a more exciting fight, but still one that he sort of got comprehensively beaten in the end. But yeah, I think Bouazizi Dan Azeez, the winner of that, is an interesting one. I think it's whether Chamberlain can kind of take that next step and beat these real sort of world-level fighters. And I don't mean we've probably really learned much by him sort of, yeah, improving, but still not really beating someone on that sort of level just yet. But yeah, it'll be exciting to, and it's always a more exciting division when you got him in the mix, because as you say, he's a game fighter. He's exciting at that weight, and he'll take anyone on. So yeah, fair play to Isaac Chamberlain. I think we need to mention a little bit Sam Gilley. He fights out of RJ's gym down in, well, it used to be near Chigwell in Essex. I think it's moved to Romford. I went down there ages ago, and I think he was just starting out at that gym, but he was sort of in an in-between area and had just lost to Danny Ball. He's kind of rebuilt his career, and to win a sort of, anyone who's winning a Commonwealth title at super welterweight deserves our credit, I'd say. But yeah, so that's kind of the Saturday's boxing. I think maybe probably worth looking forward to what we've got to excite us over the coming weeks and months. So first of all, I think this one's a real sort of juicy one, and that is not till start of December, but Hamza Shiraz against Liam Williams. What do you make of that matchup?
Yeah, I think quite interesting, to be fair, because Liam Williams is he a seasoned pro? Most probably. He's fought Liam Smith, he's fought Chris Eubank, he's been in what you could say interesting fights at his level. So I think that's a really, really positive step for Hamza Shiraz. And I think he's going to provide a tough test for him. Liam Williams has, like I say, had two great fights with Liam Smith. He's gone the distance. He went the distance with Chris Eubank Jr. Ultimately, I know he was knocked down three times, but I think that shows his toughness. So it's how much Liam Williams has got left. But I think that's the perfect fight for him at this point in his career, because you've got to take them next steps. You've got to take that. I wouldn't even say it's too early. Far from it. I don't think it's too early whatsoever. I think it's the right time to do it. And he's a very, very good fighter, Hamza Shiraz. And I think if he was going to fight anyone at this moment in time, that's the perfect fight for him. Really, really interesting. And it'd be interesting to see what the card looks like. I know it's just going to be a regular fight night, but with regards to progression and development of a fighter, I think that is such a good step, and credit to Boxer and Sky for getting that on for him and headlining a fight like that.
Yeah, I'm not sure how Hamza Shiraz will feel about going back to the Copper Box, though, because I remember watching him, must have been a little while ago, but against Bradley Skeet in there back when he was light middleweight, super welterweight. And yeah, he kind of got schooled for a few rounds, and then it was a pretty controversial ending. It ended in a people thought that Shiraz should have been DQ'd because he hit Shiraz when he was down. He hit Skeet when he was down, and then Skeet never really recovered, was knocked out in the next round. But Yeah, there was a lot of criticism of Shiraz at that point down at super welter. I think at middleweight, he has looked a completely different fighter. He's exciting. He beat Mitrofanov in his last fight, and he's sort of stepping up that next level. I think the only question is it too much too soon? But you can only really find that out by putting him in with a guy like Liam Williams. And yeah, I think it's a really exciting matchup, and you need fighters like Liam Williams to really be, it sounds like a brutal thing to call someone a gatekeeper. I don't mean it in a negative way, but in terms of that real fringe world level, you need to be able to beat someone like Liam Williams to sort of take that next step. So yeah, very exciting.
I completely agree with you, mate, and I don't think you're wrong in what you're saying at all, mate. I think Liam, how would you describe Liam Williams? If he's on the fringe of world level, I don't think Liam Williams is, at this time frame in his career, I don't think he's ever going to win a world title. I don't think he'd even be looking at that. So I think you're dead right, whether it's a gatekeeper, certainly not a journeyman, but a gatekeeper or somebody who is of a level. And if you can get through that, then you know you're on the right track to keep rising. So Liam Williams, I've always fancied, I like Liam Williams, his game as well. He's a game fighter. He'll get stuck in, he's rough and ready. And you can't buy that experience, you really can't. So yeah, it's going to be an interesting night. Like, it's very, very interesting, like you say, to see if he's at that level.
Yeah, but I'm not going to lie to you, Greg. I am pretty worried that you're not going to make it to December, because I think you might have just... You might have just done yourself in on November the 18th with the return of the big man, Nathan Heaney, against Denzel Bentley in probably, you know, Nathan Heaney's biggest fight to date, bar none, massive step up. Technically, he's not the headliner. That is Isaac Dogbo against Nick Ball. But yeah, that's an exciting little middleweight matchup for Heaney, do you not think?
Yeah, 100%. Love Heaney. And like I say, me and my brother went to watch him against Jack Flatley in Telford in March. And the atmosphere makes Heaney better. The fans that he has with him, that makes him better. And for the British title, you know, you've got to roll the dice eventually. And I mean, Flatley's not a bad level. And I think with Denzel Bentley didn't shame himself when he had that world title opportunity. So it's a tough fight. It's a really tough fight for Heaney. Don't get me wrong. I think at the moment you've got to be sitting there and saying, of course, Bentley is, of course, the favourite. And I'll be honest, as a boxing fan, I love Heaney. Staffordshire lad, I'm Cheshire way. So, you know, I do like him a lot. And I think what he's done and what he's gone on to do with his following and his career has been nothing short of outstanding. And yeah, it'll be that night. Like I said, I'm hoping to get tickets. Me and my brother are hoping to go. But I think that night will determine what Heaney goes on to do next, whether he can defend at the Bet365 stadium, because that's always been the dream. And I think he's going to be in the back of his mind thinking, this is it. This is the keys to go to the city, basically, to Stoke and having that dream night. So best of luck to Nathan Heaney. Like you say, on the undercard of, I mean, it'll be chief support. It could be co-main, really, but on a good card as well.
Yeah, I mean, it had to come at some point, didn't it? I mean, he has stepped up. He's stepped up gradually and slowly. But yeah, the Jack Flatley, a couple of fights was an exciting step up. I'm not gonna lie to you. I think Denzel Bentley's a brilliant fighter. I think he's the sort of fighter that could regroup and win a world title at some point. Yes, he's lost to sort of Felix Cash and I'm going to butcher his surname. What's his name? Alim, the Kazakhstani that he fought last time out. Alib Kinali or whatever.
Yeah. Did a good job of that, to be fair. That wasn't that bad at all, mate.
it's a collection of words or whatever that I put together. But yeah, I think it'll be exciting. It's going to be a good atmosphere in Manchester. And yeah, I mean, I think Denzel Bentley, I saw the press conference a little while ago, and it's a fight where he knows he just can't lose. I mean, he can't lose to Nathan Heaney and sort of go on the trajectory of career that he wants to do. So there's actually a lot of pressure on him to sort of deliver against Heaney. Heaney will be seeing it. I don't know. Is it pressure free, pressure off? I don't know. I think you'd have to be in his shoes a little bit to know that.
Yeah, good point, mate. I completely agree. And I think that's a real good way of looking at it. Is it pressure on and pressure off? And personally, I think he'll feel the pressure. Not feel it. I think there'll be nerves there because it's for the British title. And I think that for Nate Heaney is massive. I think winning that real first domestic title and the nights that he's brought, and I think there'll be that concern of everyone loves him. Everyone in that city loves Nate Heaney. They'll get behind him regardless. I think it is that concern. You know, it's the Mayweather effect in it. When people get beat, they worry. But he's taking that chance. He's rolling the dice. And I wish Nate Heaney nothing but the best. And I say, love the guy. I think he's brilliant. One of the nicest guys in boxing, besides Anthony Crawler. And yeah, it'll be very, very good to see him win that British title. Rooting for him.
Yeah, so that's in the MEN on the 18th of November. Yeah, an exciting little matchup. You've also got Nick Ball, at featherweight, fighting a guy who's sort of been around there and done it in Isaac Dogbo. That will technically be the headline act. I think there'll be probably more fans in for Denzel Bentley against Nathan Heaney, though, probably by some margin. But yeah, Nick Ball is sort of one of those guys that is now 18-0. He's kind of someone that we're kind of keeping quiet about in the featherweight division, which seems odd a little bit because he's right up there, I think, in my eyes.
Yeah, 100%. And again, it's interesting to see this level of fight get. I say this level of fight getting made, but it is nice to see a big fight happening for Jake Paul. And am I right in saying, George, Jake Paul, he's undefeated?
Yeah, it's Nick Ball. It's 18-0.
Sorry.
Yeah, that's all right. You were getting confused with your favourite fighter, Jake Paul, obviously.
Probably, yeah. That's the one, isn't it? Yeah. No, I think, I agree. I think it's nice. He is, like you say, undefeated, Nick Ball. And I think more so a case of just having that big night and that step up and seeing, again, like we've said about Isaac Chamberlain, really, seeing if he's at that level and if he can mix it at that level. I think that's the most important thing. And that's the biggest thing that you'll learn from that fight night. And say game fighter. And it'll be a good night of boxing, that will. That'll be a really, really good, solid night of boxing on TNT.
Yeah, so that is kind of our roundup of what's coming up, the big fights that we've picked in sort of British boxing, and what's gone on the weekend. Yeah, pleasure as always, Greg.
There was just one, George, I forgot to mention, actually. Like, we were just talking about it, and it's only a quick one from me, really, but I've always fascinated about this night, and I don't know why. But me and my brother always sit and watch it. 4th of November, there's the Monte Carlo show. The Monte Carlo boxing bonanza, and it's the maddest night because it throws up some of the maddest fights. And I think I watched the first one when it was Trent Broadhurst against Dimitri Bivol, and then you've had like Chisora versus Caballel. I think Lebedev fought Mike Wilson on one, which was the craziest fight I've seen. Luis Ortiz against Malik Scott. Just a mad night of boxing. So me and brother will be watching that, hopefully not this Saturday, coming the Saturday after. And I don't know why, I've always loved that show, so I'm looking forward to that one as well.
That's a class little shout to finish it on, yeah. Yeah, that Chisora Caballel fight, and yeah. Wow, well, I'm going to book my tickets to Monte Carlo, and I'll see you there.
Can you take me with you, mate, yeah?
Yeah, we'll stay in my pad.
Top man, cheers, mate.
Take care, Greg. Cheers, as always.
Cheers, guys. George, have a good one, mate. Cheers, everyone.